Welcome to Jazz Forum. I'm Michael Fitzgerald, Electronic Services Librarian at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. Our guest today is Bob Porter. Bob Porter has devoted his life to jazz and blues music as a producer of more than 175 albums and several hundred reissues, as a radio host on WBGO-FM in Newark, New Jersey, and as a writer for numerous jazz publications. Among his many accolades are two Grammy Awards. Bob's new book, Soul Jazz, Jazz in the Black Community, 1945 to 1975, presents an alternative view of the music, addressing figures and musical connections long overlooked in jazz history. Welcome, Bob.
Mike, nice to see you.
Good to see you. I know as a writer, sometimes it feels like a book takes a lifetime, but for you, I think, you know, it's really the case. This is something that has been your interest and your passion and your professional work for over 50 years.
Oddly enough, the book actually took shape the first time in 1991. I was doing a radio show called Portraits in Blue, and I hooked up with a real good New York photographer named Joe Rosen, and we were going to do a coffee table kind of thing. And we got a deal with a little brown. And then we were passed around from editor to editor, and then finally the last editor decided he didn't want the book. So we went out looking again, and then with nothing happening, we finally decided to part ways. And since I had invested enough in the project already, I figured I might as well try on my own. So I met with Sheldon Meyer from Oxford University Press. And unfortunately, Sheldon passed away about 18 months after the deal. And I could never hook up with anybody else at Oxford, so I decided to do it myself.
But this, the content of the book has been really the passion of your life.
Well, I've been around for a lot of it, and that I haven't been around for, I was able to discover just through talking to musicians. The best way to learn about this music, if you're not a player, is to talk to other musicians.
How did you get an opportunity to do that?
Well, I got a chance to know people. I mean, one of the ways you get into the music business is you need to know somebody. I got to know a gentleman named Don Schlitten, who was working at Prestige Records at the time, and he suggested to Bob Weinstock, whom I had already met, that I might be a guy to work on the Soul Jazz roster. This is in 1968, so I was hired to work at Prestige and started my career then.
And who were some of the artists that you worked with at Prestige?
Well, the first one was Richard Groove Holmes. Later on, I got a chance to work with Gene Ammons, Charles Erland, Houston Person. A lot of great players.
And you were, it seems like you were, there was a specific corner of the Prestige sound that they had you involved in. What was that?
Well, basically, the organ and tenor thing had been a very strong part of the Prestige catalog since the late 50s. And it had fallen into disrepair for a while, so they brought me in to try and revive it. And I think I succeeded.
And, you know, what was it like to work with Gene Ammons?
Gene Ammons was a very interesting man from a number of perspectives. He's colored by the long stretch in prison that he spent, but when he came out, he didn't seem bitter at all. He seemed to think that because he was an out-of-control narcotics addict when he went in, he thought that the prison term saved his life. And when he came back, he didn't have long to live after he came back, only about 5 years. But he packed a lot of good music in the 5 years.
Now, you know, I would think that for someone like you, having an opportunity to record and to work with Gene Ammons was like a dream come true.
Sure, he was my favorite musician.
How did you come to know him, and how did you come to be involved in jazz in the first place?
When I first started with Prestige, he was in prison. And I went to Bob Weinstock and I asked whether or not he had heard anything from Gene, and he said no. So I said, well, let me write him and I'll send him a copy of some of the promotional flyers that we have on some of his most recent stuff and see what he thinks. So I wrote him and he was very grateful. He wrote me back. And so when I first met him after he came out of prison, he already knew me to a certain extent, and that helped smooth things out easier. He is just a truly gifted player, gifted band leader too. He really knew how to work an audience.
And so you worked with Prestige starting in 1968.
68 until the label was sold in 71.
And one of the next most important things you did was you got involved with Savoy Records.
Savoy starts in 1975, shortly after Herman Lubinsky, the original Savoy owner, had passed. The label was sold to Arista, and I was hired by a gentleman named Steve Backer to do the reissues for Arista. And I had a real good time doing that. That's where I really learned about vault research and the quality that you need to have a good reissue program.
And if I'm correct, I think your first Grammy Award was for the Charlie Parker?
Yes, the Charlie Parker box set, yes.
And your second Grammy Award was for the Atlantic Records box set.
Well, oddly enough, that was a different story, but it's similar circumstances. When I was hired by Ahmet Erdogan, he wanted me to revive his black music catalog, which by the mid-80s had once again been shunted to the background, largely because the English rock stuff was so hot on Atlantic. So I was the one guy who worked on the project, and I worked with Ahmet's nephew, Aziz Coxell, and we finally got this project put together, and there are actually several different versions of it. One's on LP, and the other one on CD, and then I think there was a box set.
And it's called Atlantic Rhythm and
Blues. Atlantic
Rhythm
and Blues, yes.
1947 to 1975.
Right.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about who Ahmet Erdogan was?
Well, Ahmet Erdogan was the son of a diplomat, the first Turkish ambassador to the United States, in fact. Prior to coming to the United States, he was brought up in Paris and in the court of St. James before he came here. So the diplomatic life was kind of inbred in him, and he always acted the perfect gentleman. He was the unusual person who was comfortable in any social situation. I guess he knew who he was, so it worked. But he was really a fanatic when it came to blues piano. He loved to listen to blues piano players. He would rather listen to Fats Domino than I think anything in the world.
And he, of course, as the son of an ambassador, lived here in Washington.
Yes.
And was influential in you know, they had jam sessions at the Turkish embassy here.
Well, the old story was the only place you could go to hear an integrated jazz group in Washington, D.C. was Sunday afternoons at the Turkish embassy.
And there's some wonderful photographs that William Gottlieb took of that. And, you know, members of the Duke Ellington band, after they play at the Howard Theater, back to the Turkish embassy.
And sometimes they'd bring people down from New York, Sidney Bechet, for example, or Pete Johnson, people like. He loved to mix things up. I think that's where Ahmet, in fact, Ahmet gets his jazz interest largely from his brother Nesuri, mm-hmm. who was 6 years older and was a more involved professionally in jazz before Ahmet was. In 1944, Nesuri cut the Kid Ory Band, one of the great New Orleans revival groups, for his own Crescent label. Great records.
Yeah. And I mean, the history of Atlantic Records really, you know, is tremendous in both the blues, R&B, and jazz. Well, and I mean, that's something that you knew walking in the door, you know, in the 80s.
Well, I was very fortunate in the fact that the first time I met Ahmet Erdogan was because he was looking for a record that nobody could find. He had this group called the Honey Drippers, which was a super group made up of British rockers.
Right.
And he wanted them to do a Roy Brown tune entitled Rockin' at Midnight. And everybody kept bringing him Good Rockin' Tonight. And so I got a call from a mutual friend of ours to find out whether I had it. And I said, yes, I have it. And so I brought it in to him. And rather than getting paid, I asked the secretary to let me pick some records from the catalog. So I'm going through the catalog and picking out things, and he comes out of a meeting. And I happen to mention to her, you know, I've known this about this man for many years, but never met him. Would it be possible to, you know, just say hello and things like that? So after a hiatus of 15 or 20 minutes, she ushered me in, and I was there for 2.5 hours. And when I left the conversation, he says, I want you to come to Atlantic and help me to revive the Black Music catalog. How's that for an afternoon?
Sure. Now, this book presents, you know, what I called, you know, an alternative view of jazz history. And I think it really is kind of a response to the way that the story of jazz has been told over the years in books and college courses and textbooks and things like that. Is that how you look at it?
To a certain extent, yes. I'm not trying to pick fights with anybody, but I'm just suggesting that there is another way to look at this. You know, generally speaking, you did not have jazz writers commenting on a political or social situation when they were writing about records or talking about jazz. But the fact of the matter is this, in 1945, America was a segregated country. And Black people had their own way of doing things. They had their own way of playing the music and responding to the music. And that was not necessarily the music that you saw written about in the press. Not a lot of jazz critics went to hear music in Harlem in the 50s and 60s. I heard a lot of it in Harlem. And that's largely where my, you know, where things got straight in my head. That's where I heard it, and that's where I thought it ought to go, so to speak.
And who were some of the artists that you were able to hear and that you recognized as being important who weren't necessarily being recognized elsewhere?
Well, Willis Jackson is a good example. A tenor player who was around for years. He did R&B session work in the 50s. He came up with Cootie Williams' band with that squealing stuff on parts one and two of Gator Tail. But he got into what is one of the great soul jazz groups of the 1950s, when he had Jack McDuff on organ and Bill Jennings on guitar. And they made some wonderful music together, which nobody talks about. And I said to myself, if he's this good, what else is there out there that nobody's talking about? I found a lot of it.
And I mean, certainly the organ group, I think, is an important aspect of the style that I think some people, you know, it gets sort of lumped together and then ignored.
Well, there are different ways of playing organ, although it's really Jimmy Smith that makes the difference. Your earlier artists of Milt Buckner, or Bill Doggett, or Wild Bill Davis tended to approach the instrument as kind of an orchestral thing. They were all arrangers. They all loved the chordal aspect of it. Jimmy Smith is different. He's a single line player. He's like a Bud Powell on organ, if you can imagine that. And he does it with one hand because his left hand walks the bass.
Right.
And that, of course, is something that he brought to the instrument that the other guys weren't doing. And Jimmy Smith is the unheralded artist of his time. If you were asked to name the biggest selling jazz artist of the 1960s, I think you'd probably initially say Dave Brubeck or Miles Davis or somebody else. Not even close. Jimmy Smith buries everybody. He's just a huge presence on the scene that was barely acknowledged for the most part. But I think it's largely because his audience is basically Black. He played Black venues, Black neighborhoods. And by the time the mid-60s rolls around, yes, he's playing festivals and things like that, and he's going to Europe and Japan. But in large measure, where he came from was the Black community.
And, you know, it seems like there's a particular style, you know, the organ combo with, you know, tenor and guitar and drums, that sound, it was kind of the sound of the Black neighborhood in a lot of ways.
Sure, and to a certain extent, by having an organ, you don't need a bass. So it saves you a little bit of money for a club owner.
And tuning pianos as well.
Well, yes. and of course, the horn players appreciate they don't have to play to an out-of-tune instrument. But what it comes down to is this, is that music turned out to be, I think, the preferred social music for Black adults. Because there were no vocals, it wasn't a big deal if they were talking during the performance. They could sit back and listen and dig what was happening if they wanted to, or they could schmooze, or they could drink, or do whatever it was. It had great utility. that music. It was accompanimental, if that's what you wanted to, or it could be right in the foreground if you wanted to pay attention and dig what was going on in the bandstand.
And so, I mean, obviously Jimmy Smith was a pioneer in the in the mid-50s, I guess.
He is probably the single greatest artist of the music. Gene Ammons probably the greatest single saxophonist. They all hit their peak about the same time, years 57 to 62. That's really when it happens for them. Jimmy Smith, of course, goes on to even greater success when he teams up with Oliver Nelson. Mm-hmm. And they build a big band around his organ playing, which was an unusual sound for that time. But it worked incredibly well.
Sure. And I guess the other thing maybe to think about is, you said, you know, in terms of record sales, you know, Jimmy Smith was very successful. What about the, you know, the how the records were presented, how they were marketed, how they were issued? Certainly, the, you know, starting in the 19, you know, the early 50s, the LP was how jazz was coming out, but it was a little different for some of the music in the black community.
Well, black people were used to buying 45s as opposed to LPs. That's where the rhythm and blues market stayed. Jazz albums routinely outsold LPs by some of your strongest rhythm and blues artists in the 50s and early 60s. That's simply because the audience wanted 45s rather than LPs. Jazz fans accepted the 12-inch LP, and that was what they preferred. You had wars in between 78s and 45s and 10-inch LPs and 12-inch LPs. It's 1956 before they settle on a 12-inch LP, and that's really spurs growth in the jazz record industry, beginning about that time.
And then I guess, you know, on sort of the flip side of that, so to speak, was it 1969, the stereo and mono problems?
Well, 67. Columbia Record pressed a lot of material for other labels, independent labels. They had a custom pressing division, and that's where, for example, Prestige or Riverside or other labels may press their records rather than going to an independent press. Columbia could provide certain services, and they were very good with deadlines, things like that, and their quality was acceptable, well above acceptable, actually. But in 1967, Monaural Records on Columbia had fallen to the point where Clive Davis said, well, let's get rid of Monaural as a way to listen to music and make it all stereo. And that changed things considerably. Because a lot of the black community, they didn't even have stereo equipment. They were perfectly content to listen to jazz in mono. And of course, mono was the way the 45s were played. But there was a schism right there. Straight ahead jazz record sales never really recovered after that time. Your great period of prestige in Blue Note and Riverside and Contemporary and labels such as that was prior to 1967.
And then that period was, which is when you entered the world professionally, yeah, as a producer at Prestige. Up until your cutoff date for this book is 1975, which I guess is for what reason?
Well, two things. Politically, it works out because I start the book at the end of World War II, and 75 is the end of Vietnam War. But at the same time, 1975 is the year that disco comes along. And disco is one of those cataclysmic events that seems to happen periodically. The English rockers in the 60s, disco in the 70s, it just flattened everything in the sight. And it didn't matter whether you were a country and western label or a jazz label. If you didn't have disco, you didn't have anything. Mm. And it took a long time for that to recover.
Certainly the music has changed, even just in the, you know, in the period of time that we're talking about here, 45 to 75. In that latter period from 67 to 75, what was different about the music then than, you know, let's say the early 60s?
45 to 60, you think? Well, the early 60s, you have a lot more experimentation. You have a lot of different ways of doing things. Prior to bebop, you had pretty much of a consensus as to what swing was and how to do it. Yes, the black artists swung a little bit differently than some of the white swing bands, for example, but there's still basically, it's four on the floor. Bebop changes that to a certain extent. Not as much, I think, as people think, because virtually everything there is in 4/4 time, too, and it certainly swings. But when you get into the innovations, if you will, of the late 50s, early 60s, you have drummers who play differently. Elvin Jones certainly played differently than Joe Jones or Roy Haynes, for example. And his rhythms were different from their rhythms. So all of a sudden you have not a consensus, but a question as to how you're going to do something, whereas before you knew that.
And then what about later players? So someone like, you know, Bernard Purdy.
Well, Bernard Purdy comes out of the funk tradition. He was a rhythm and blues artist, and he is somebody who was, I think, from the 1960s, everybody's favorite funk R&B drummer. He just had great feel for the music, and he was a great individual personality. You could not have a bad time if he was in the room.
I guess one of the other things to think about is you know, in this book, looking at under-recognized figures, what's the importance of the local scenes as opposed to just, you know, people who play in New York or played in Los Angeles?
Well, in a large measure, the music business is concentrated, jazz business is concentrated in Los Angeles or New York. That tends to be where your record labels are located, but it's also where your music publishers and your booking agencies and things like that are located. So players tend to come to those areas where they can essentially visit their money, if you know what I mean. They can go and do some business while they are there. If you live in Seattle or if you live in Dallas, it's not that easy. So I think that those areas and the reasons that they became so prominent is largely because that's where the business was located. You could become discovered easier in those communities than you might be in Cincinnati or Minneapolis or something like that.
And who are some of the important players that might be considered as local players that you cover in this book?
Well, local players? I think that what I cover in the book is largely under-recognized people with a national reputation.
But who started off?
You could find people like, for example, just in this area here, Buck Hill is a fine tenor player. But he's different in the sense that he chose to live at home. Oftentimes you have career decisions based on family matters or the ability to provide for a family rather than bouncing around the road pursuing your muse, so to speak. There tend to be other reasons as well that people don't travel, but the one thing you can't take away from a musician is either he's got it or he doesn't have it. And if you're lucky enough to hear a musician who you've heard about but haven't seen because he is local, you're lucky, because a lot of other people don't. I talk about hearing Winston Walls in Charleston, West Virginia. I happened to be on a trip visiting relatives, and this is a guy I had heard about for years. I went out to hear, but he played only one tune that I wanted to hear, but it was as good as anything I've ever heard in my life. Mm-hmm. So you have to be lucky like that. I discovered Rusty Bryant in Columbus, Ohio. That was home territory for him. That's right. Where he lived. Right. And so we heard him and got him a chance to record for Prestige, and we had some hits with him.
And you, for decades now, you've been on the radio at WBGO-FM in Newark, New Jersey, which is home to, you know, a number of wonderful players.
Well, I think we can say without much equivocation that we are the world's jazz station, in the sense that we stream worldwide. We have contributor members in, I think it's like 45 countries. So we are heard all over the world, quite literally.
And your program, Portraits in Blue.
Portraits in Blue started in 1981 as in response to Al Pryor, who was our program director at that time, asked for things that might be offered to NPR for syndication. And it was syndicated for about 15 years. I once had 44 stations carrying the show. But in time, it became too much of a headache to do it in that fashion. Now, of course, it streams all over the place. But in 1999, WBGO had a hole on Saturday morning, so I said, give me Saturday morning. So I started a show which was blues and rhythm and blues from classic soul called The Saturday Morning Function. That's still going. And then recently I decided I want to get back to playing jazz again, so I started the WBGO Swing Party on Sunday mornings.
Yeah. And I think, you know, the idea of bringing jazz and blues together is something that's important in this book, and it's something that you've done on your radio programs as well.
Well, I think to a certain extent they were together at the start. That is to say, it was all viewed as race music initially. But over time, when you have these new terms, new ideas, new changes in the music coming along, you get some people who jumped on the bandwagon and other people who get off the bus.
Well, thank you, Bob. Our guest today on Jazz Forum has been Bob Porter, jazz record producer, radio host, and author of the new book, Soul Jazz, Jazz in the Black Community, 1945 to 1975. Jazz Forum is a production of the Felix E. Grant Jazz Archives and the Jazz Studies Program at the University of the District of Columbia. If you'd like more information about the Felix E. Grant Jazz Archives or the Jazz Studies Program at UDC, please visit our website at www.jazzarchives.org. I'm Michael Fitzgerald. Thanks for watching. See you next time.